Hello, I'm Jörg Steffens from Bareos, from the Bareos project. And in my presentation, I like to give an overview about the Bareos software, Bareos backup solutions for people new to Bareos. So what will be covered is, yuck. Don't move the laptop. Okay. So what will be covered is tell what Bareos is about, what this is, what this feature set is, about the Bareos architecture, the installation of Bareos, the basic workflows, and then also get some configuration examples and show how to extend it. Also, I will give outlook to the roadmap for the upcoming features, for the upcoming versions. So, what is Bareos? It's a multi-platform backup solution working over the network. It's 100% open source, obviously, otherwise we wouldn't be here. The source is available at GitHub. The core components are written in C++, and it started as a fork from Bacula in 2010. Maybe some of you knew Bacula, or not, okay. The first public release has been 2013. This has been Bareos 12.4.3. And we, from then on, we have done a major release every year. And the current release is Bareos 16.2.4. Some people ask what the version number come from. So the mouse is also visible. Yes. So 12 here or 16 is the year of the code freeze, and the second number is the quarter of the code freeze, and then you have an minor numbering for the different versions. So the current version has been the code freeze in the middle of last year. Multi-platform, the Bareos project itself provides packages for all major Linux distributions, or a lot of Linux distributions, packages for Windows, 32-bit and 64-bit, Mac OS clients, and on customer requests, Bareos.com also provides packages for FreeBSD or for some Unix like AIX or HPOX or Solaris. It's also integrated in some distributions. I'm aware of Arch Linux, Debian, FreeBSD, Gentoo, and because it's included in Debian, it's also available at Ubuntu Universe. If you're asked what version you should use, the version integrated in your distribution or the version from Bareos.org, yeah, it depends on the features you want to use, especially for Debian. Debian Stable includes the Bareos 14.2 version currently, which is a working version, of course, but some features have been introduced later on, so you should decide. If you set up a new server, maybe you start, give it a try with Bareos.org. How does an environment with Bareos looks like? You have your backup servers components somewhere here. On every client you want to backup, you have to install the Bareos client called Bareos File Daemon, because it backups the files from the systems. And you have some special plugins for backing up, for example, VMware environments, or MS SQL cluster, or backup NDMP. Also, if you may use some cluster file system like ClusterFS or Ceph, then these normally are highly redundant, but nevertheless, it makes sense to also back up your hard cluster file system. Where is the data stored? Most people start with storing them to disk, so on files again. A lot of environments, large environments, use tape auto changers, tape overwards, which still makes sense and have some advantages. Or you can also store them to some the same cluster file system like ClusterFS and Ceph. You have your central components and your control, have your runtime control via a web frontend or a text-based console. I will come to this later on. Features. Hopefully all the features that you expect from a backup software are included. Bareos distinguish between different backup types, like full backup, differential backup, and incremental backups. And newly introduced is the always incremental. So in this case, on your client, so the Barrios client, which might be your server, only incrementals are run, and only the incrementals are sent to the server, so minimizing the amount of data sent to the server. But if you're using always incremental, then the server size has more to do like consolidating your jobs and recreating full backup sets again if you configure it this way. But it's not only about backing up the data, backing up the file, but also about managing of your backups. So normally backups are done to volumes, which might be a tape, might be a disk file or something like this, and you assign special properties to these volumes, like the retention periods, meaning you define for a volume how long you want to keep the data on this volume. And yeah, Barrios will care about that these retention periods are fulfilled. You have a flexible scheduling for your jobs and also quite flexible with your network setup. The different interfaces, I already mentioned them. You have the B-console text-based interface. We have the Barrios Web UI. It's a PHP front end. I will show it later on. And from the Bacula fork, we still got the BATS Qt-based console, which is also quite in some use. However, we hope we have now integrated all the relevant features from BAT into the Web UI and therefore marked BAT as deprecated for Barrios. If you're doing your backup, of course you want to secure your data, but also the backup system itself should be quite secure. And yeah, we have a challenge response authentication mechanism. For the transport, for the network transport, it can be configured to use TLS. Data can be encrypted on the client in software, which means the advantage is it is it's encrypted on the client, and the server only sees the encrypted data. So this is good for security reasons. It might have some disadvantages if your client really crashes and the hard disk is broken, because this is the only one who can decrypt the data. But you can still define a master key so that you can also decrypt it on some other places. It's then your choice how to handle this. Making this on the client in software has also some other disadvantages. For example, if a full backup job runs on my laptops on Friday, then of course my room is stored on an encrypted file system, so the kernel decrypts all the data, then Barrios encrypts them again and moves them over to the server. That's normally a good time to make a lunch break or something like this, because you will notice this. On the other hand side, you can only also encrypt data on the back end. For example, if you just store it to disk, you can use a normal Linux encrypted file system for this. But also on tape, since common tape technology is LTO, this is mostly used now, and I think until LTO 3 or 4, they offer encryption by default, and then it's done in hardware. So Barrios keeps the management of the keys to encrypt the data, and the tape drive itself will encrypt and decrypt the data that you store to it. The advantage is, it's there, you have already bought it, and it doesn't slow down your backup. Of course, it's something else if it's stored on the encrypted on the backend or on your client, but nevertheless. Barrios has quite some flexible logging mechanism, and by default you also got your an audit log, so a special log file which tells who did connect to the backup server and issued what commands on the command line. On customer request, we also added a secure erase command. This is all files that are created by Barrios will then also be deleted with a secure erase command like wipe, for example, which hopefully guarantees that the file is really deleted from your hard disk. Some financial institutes have some requirements in this respect, and for us it has been easy to add. We have quite powerful ACL support. I'll give an example later on. And if you want to back up all your data on your client, and also restore it to the same client, of course your client needs to have all file permissions to do so. Normally on Linux, the file daemon runs as root and have access to all the files. But you can also configure it in other ways that it made only be able to do backups or only to do restores or run as a different users, and you can specify the commands that are allowed to be executed by the file daemon. So you have some security options included. Features, you can build your scripts around barriers. There is a special presentation about this later on. You can extend the functionalities by plugins. You will also need so if I will show some examples later on. If you run this environment, you can also define quotas for specific jobs, so that specific systems only can back up this amount of data, and otherwise you have soft quotas and hard quotas. And it also integrates with some other open source software, for example, Relax and Recover. Various architecture. We have a picture before, but now I want to show it in a bit more detail. So in your various backup environment, you have one central director who controls all your backups, when they are started and things like this. You can have one or multiple storage daemon, and to each storage daemon you can attach one or more storage devices. Like said before, this tape, cloud storage, something like this. And then you have the clients connected to it. The director itself stores all the persistent information to a database called catalog. And yes, you can connect to the director via this so-called Barrios Director Console interface. So the web UI uses the same command sets as the text console. Yes?
Why having different storage daemons if you can attach different storage areas to the same storage daemon?
Good question. The question is why you have more than one storage daemon, because you can attach multiple storage devices to one storage anyway. The answer is because maybe you have different locations. So you have one location, second location, and maybe even if you have different data centers, you can back up all the data to one storage system. But if then you may get a disaster and the building burns down, you can have also your job scheduled that to replicate the data to another storage daemon.
So the storage daemon can be remote?
They are all, this is remote, and the communication lines you see here is all TCP.
Okay.
Okay, in a bit more detail, the file daemon runs on every client you want to back up. It can read files, it can write files, verify files. It's not only reading the contents, but also the attributes, ACLs, extended attributes. On Windows, it's also responsible to do the VSS snapshots. You can configure checksum calculation, which makes sense if you really want to check if a file content have changed. It's responsible also for encryption, we noted this before, and also for compression. And it can run scripts that you defined on the server for the client and be extended with plugins.
Continuous backup is not supported, like via iNotify or... It's not supported.
Only in special respect, for example, in the VMware environment, we have changed block tracking, and then we can do something like this. Otherwise, you have to create a plugin to fulfill this, because you don't have a standard mechanism that we can use on all systems. But yes, we would like to have this feature. Storage daemon, I mentioned this before, you attach the different storage devices, and also it's just thing like if you have your tape library, do the barcode labeling and keeping care of this. Yes, as said before, if you have multiple storage daemon, you can migrate or copy jobs from one storage daemon to the other. Also changing, for example, the compression or things like this via you migrate the job. And also cares about errors like tape alerts and things like this. The database called Catalog is an SQL database supported by PostgreSQL, MySQL, SQLite. If you don't have specific preferences, just choose Postgres. The director handles the data in the catalog, does all the media and volume handling, pool handling, scheduling, triggering of the jobs, so starting the backup jobs, caring about the restore jobs and things like this. Keeps messages that it receives and also are able to run job on the server. Network connectivity, the network connection between the different components are not permanent, but as they are only established when they are required. And normally it works this way. If you have a new backup job, then the director tells the storage daemon that soon there will be a client which connects to the storage daemon to store its data there. After this, it connects to the client and tells him, you should now run your backup job and store it to this storage daemon. So the director is not really involved with the data anymore, but only for establishing the connection and doing the authentication between the components.
The client needs to see the storage daemon. Like they need to be able to talk one with the other, client and storage daemon.
Yes, in a way.
So, like, you can't have all the traffic go through the direct.
No, that's nothing that you want to have. But what you can do, because, for example, as I told now, the director connects to the storage daemon, connects to the file daemon, and the file daemon connects to the storage daemon. This doesn't work in some environments, for example, in your DMZ, where your backup systems are stored, allocated in your central, in your local network, and you have a server you want to backup in your DMZ. Then the DMZ servers can't connect to your local network. So for this, we have the passive client. In this case, the initiation is the other way around. So, don't get confused by this. The
storage daemon pulls data from the file daemon. So you have to expose the file daemon in that way, though.
Yeah, sure. So the other systems has to be able to connect to this, and the file daemon would be talk. There will be a storage daemon, this storage daemon that will connect to you soon. So the other way around. Okay. The other way, it's also on customer request, is that the director can't connect to the file daemon. In this way, you can use a client-initiated connection, where the connection will be established from the client to the director. In this case, it will be a permanent connection, network connection, and if the director has done a job for the client, it will reuse the already existing connection. Okay. Installation of Bareos. As we started this project, we want to make sure that an installation of your backup system is quite easy and quite fast to handle this. So these are the steps to get a working backup environment, in limited sense. First, you have to decide what database you want to use and install it on the system. Then you add the Bareos repository if you want to use the package for at Bareos.org. You install the endowed only the Bareos package, which is a meter package, which pulls all the other packages. And then again, depending on your distribution, you have to run a few scripts to prepare your database. For example, on Debian or Ubuntu, this is done automatically, but on other distributions, you have to run these scripts. So after this, you can start the daemon, you start the director, you start the storage daemon, the file daemon is already started, and then you have a working Bareos environment which runs a job every day to at least backup itself. So you have a working environment and working configuration, and you can just extend it. Yes?
Yeah, you mentioned that you can have encrypted backups and the keys are managed in the Bareos database. How do you back up encrypted backups? I mean, how do you back up Bareos in encrypted backups? Or how do you restore them? which is the more interesting question.
So the key management has been if you have tapes and you see a tape SCSI crypto settings for this, and in this case, yeah, then the keys are transferred to storage daemon when they are needed.
But if you want to make a recovery because your barrier is
yes.
Fresh, how do you get the keys out of the storage then?
Yes. For all these respects, for most of these respects, we have a command line tool. So you mean a disaster recovery where your backup server also crashes. For each job or for important job like backup the own database, there will be an extra message generated, normally sent to the administrator, which have some information to restore this only this single job by command line tools from the medium itself.
Which contains the keys.
I'm not sure about the keys in this environment, but yeah, you should take care that you have the keys somewhere stored, but probably they are there. I had to check how to do this properly. Okay. Packages, we tried to split barriers into functional units. You get the packages from downloadbarrios.org, barrios release latest. As said, if you want to have a full environment, you can just select install the barrios package. It will trigger, it will have dependencies to the other packages that it requires. Normally, it also chooses the correct database backend packages if the database is already installed on the same system. If not, you have to verify that you installed the correct database backend package. On the clients, you only need to install the Barrios file daemon. And on the server, it might also make sense to install the Barrios web UI if you want to have the web UI running. We build our packages using a private instance of the open build service. .org, so OpenSUSE build service. This is in essence. You see here some of the distributions. Most packages are built directly from the main Git repository, Barrios Barrios. Some other, like the documentation, are only built on Debian and then exported to the web server. And some plugins, we build just for specific platforms which fulfill the requirements for these plugins. Yes. What's also quite interesting that we can also use this to build the Windows packages. We build them by cross-compiling them on /12. And you see here we build the packages WinBarrios for 32-bit and for 64-bit and the installer and so on.
What architectures do you support?
Okay, these are only built for Intel. And yeah, of course, it's integrated in Debian, and there we see that it's also used on other architectures. More questions? No.
Well, is it backwards compatible? For instance, if I use Debian, you said that it contains an older file. And can I use that within?
Yes. So the question has been, can I use the current Barrios director with older version of the file daemon? Yeah, definitely. You can use all Barrios versions against the new, the current file daemon. And you can also use the backward lines, at least up until 5.2. But then, of course, you cannot use all the features. Windows client. I'm not sure if somebody is using Windows here, but it has an NSI installer, and then you can select the components that you want to install and run it. And you already configure it with this front end here. Normally, you only install the file daemon, so the client components, but it also includes the server, the storage daemon, so you can do run your full installation, your full Barrios environment on Windows, but you shouldn't. It also includes the web UI there. Has some features like that the Windows firewall is configured accordingly, and has also silent install options. So if you not only want to install it on one system, but on a bigger set of on more Windows systems, then you can do this with command line and command line arguments configure it. Management Windows software. We often use OPSI, the open source solution OPSI, to manage software on Windows. And because we like this, we already creating packages usable with OPSI. We have also debug packages, which include source code. And so if you run this on Windows, you can use your GDB on Windows and can debug it there, which you only also don't want.
Is it possible to backup for a bare metal distro of Windows?
No, not on Windows. Yeah, we have done some experiments with this, but in principle you can backup the full system and restore it, but before this you have to initialize, format the hard disk accordingly and things like this. So in very simple setups where you know how your hard disk did look like beforehand, you can do so, and we have done some experiments with this, but as a general solution, good as relax and recover, no. Relax and recover for Linux. So.
I have a question.
Yes?
How many clients can
a
serve?
Yeah, we have environments with at least 1,000 clients or more.
Just one daemon server?
The director, just one director, but multiple storage daemons the data is sent to.
And what happens if a daemon dies?
The client dies?
No, if the storage daemon dies.
Then the job will fail. Normally, so
the director would assign another daemon for the client?
No, not automatically. So if some system broke, one of your storage daemons, then yeah, you have to fix it and reconfigure your jobs. So the jobs that using the storage daemon will fail during this time.
Do you have HA for the director?
No. I think we have done this in some projects, but not as a common solution. Okay, workflow. So if you have your BIOS environment set up, you can start the command line tool B console, which opens a TCP connection to the director. Do the authentication there, and then gives you an interactive prompt to type in your commands to interact with the BIOS daemon. Type in help, and you get the list of all available commands. If you then, for example, want to start a job, run a backup job, you type in run, then it will show you the list of jobs that are available. Here we have chose 4 for backup client 1, which is the default job. If you selected it, it will give you an overview of what it does intend to do. So let's use a backup client 1 job name. It will do an incremental backup. The client is named BariosFD. Fileset defines the files that should get backupped, and here where the backup will be stored when it's will be done. And then you have the choice to modify the settings or run the job. If you say run the job, then a new job is generated and a new job ID, and it tells you the job ID for this job and also tells you, oh, okay, here something happens, I have got new messages. Oops. You can then type in messages and see what he wants to tell you. And in this case, what's just important, it has been the first job on this client. So it says, okay, you have selected incremental backup, but I haven't any full backups before, so I upgraded this to full and to a full backup. It tells you what storage device it will use and what volume the data will be written on. And when it's finished, this has been a small job, it gives you a summary about what has happened, how many files have been saved, and what amount of data. But the important part is backup okay, so it did work fine. If you start the job for a second time, it gets the next job ID. Same before, just it doesn't upgrade to full because you have a backup job before. And the summary says, okay, it's an incremental, it's only 10 minutes after the first one, so nothing has changed, so I don't have written any files and not and 0 bytes, and therefore I also haven't used any volume to store the data to, but backup is still okay because I fulfill JIT job. You can do the same in the web UI. So here you have typed in one to in the B console to get the list of clients where to back up. In the web UI, you have this job action view. There you get the list of your jobs. And then here you can start a job on the specific the specific job. If you would have typed in list jobs on the B console, it would show you something like this. Is this readable? More or less, if I wasn't in the way. So here you see, okay, there has been a job job ID 1, 2, 3. 3 is the job we started before. It's on the backup client 1. The job has been named backup client 1. The client has been backup FD. This has been of a type backup. It has been a full job. And the number of files we have seen before, and here again succeeded. And then you got the choice to rerun the job, which normally makes sense if a job did fail for some reason and you have fixed the reason, or to get a list of the file in the restore browser of this job. And also the second job, incremental with 0 bytes and so on, it's also available here.
You also restore a track of file from the B console?
Pardon?
So you said you can see the files?
Yeah.
And you restore any, select any file and
yes.
Restore it from the B console?
Yes, sure. So the B console has been there first and offers all the commands, and the web UI is only front end on it and uses the same connection. It issues the same command as you type in the B console. List jobs I had before. If you go to the job details, you can see the job log that we have seen before at this messages. So if you type in the B console list job log, you would see roughly the same content here. And then, of course, important for a backup solution is also to restore the things. And if you select something or go to the restore browser, you select from what backup from what client you want to restore, then you get a list of all the backups that did run for this client. Then you can decide that you only want to see this single job or want to merge it up until the next full. So only if you have done an incremental, not only the files that I include in the incremental, but the incremental before, and the incremental before, and the incremental before, until they have been a full job. You can select where you want to restore it. Do you want to restore it on the same machine or on another machine? And what should happen with the files there? Should they be overwritten by the backup, or should they be placed somewhere else, or whatever? Okay, this has been a quick overview about the workflow. The barriers configuration. So with the web UI and in the B console, you trigger actions, but the configuration, like adding new jobs or configure file sets, you have to done in the configuration files. Each daemon has its own configuration file. With the current version, we splitted them into a directory structure with resource types and then specific resources. For example, a file set defines what job will be backupped. I just sat down because maybe you see them better. Okay. Here we have a file set resource. We give it a name, Linux all, which means we want to backup all the files that are included on a Linux system. Therefore, we define the root directory to be the source of the backup. But the default setting is that it backups only one file system. This makes sense because you don't want to backup proc or sys or tempfs, something like this. But here, in this case, we want to have a configuration that backups all the files. So we choose another way. We start at the root directory, say, use all, not only limit to one file system, but backup all the file systems of type butterfs, x4, zfs, and backup them. The list in the original is much longer, but I think you get the idea for this. And excludes all the files that are at the temp directory.
If you would backup butterfs or zfs, how would you handle different subvolumes?
It's a file-based backup in this case, so it backups the files that it sees at this situation. Other way is if you only manage your central backup environment, but want to let the administrator of the different clients decide what files to backup, you can use a construct like file. This is backslash less than and then a file name. No, it's not a less than, but it should be. But I wasn't able to get it in the presentation, so it should be like this. Look it up in the configuration, and then on the client machine, the administrator of the client machine has the option to specify what files or what directories he wants to get backupped, and so you can handle this. This can be combined easily with quota, so you can limit the amounts of data which the administrator can back up.
So there is no integration with like CFS snapshots or B3FS snapshots or something similar?
No, not in this case. Mm-hmm. It's just file-based, and we have different plugins for other things.
Ah, but I think if you, I don't know for Barreiros, but I know for Bakla, you can like start the scripts.
Sure.
So you can make a snapshot and then list from the...
I meant about some direct.
No. We come to the scripts later on. So scheduling, you can define schedules. This is also a default schedule delivered with the default configuration. And it did say, run a full backup on every first Sunday of the month at this time. Run a differential backup on the second to fifth Sunday of the month, and from Monday to Saturday, just do an incremental backup. Things like this. A client will look like this. You give it a name, you give it an address, normally DNS or IP address, and here to find a password. And then a job is just a combination of all the other resources. So you give it a name for the specific job. You say what client should be backupped, what file set should be backed up, when it should be backed up, to what storage it should get backed up, how the messages that are created are handled, and where to store them on different pools. There's no configuration for volumes, so for single tapes, but just a pool, and this assigns specific settings to a set of volumes.
Can you specify multiple storage areas or just one? Like, can you this one, or if it doesn't work, this one? Or
No. It's
just one.
Yes.
And in the storage definition, storage definition is one per storage daemon. So.
No, there can be multiple. You can access multiple
storage areas.
Yes.
Right. Okay.
But you define it here. You can overwrite it in your when you start a job, but it doesn't handle this automatically. It's just does what you have defined here.
Can I start a backup from triggered by the client? For instance, if a laptop connects to a network, to the home network. Then the laptop then start a backup?
Something similar will be in my presentation about Barreiros scripting later on today.
Okay.
Yes. But nothing that's really included, some Python codes, 5 lines around it. Okay, I see 15 minutes left, so I do it quick. You have your full pool, so it's where your full backup will be stored, and there you define how long they should get be kept. So everything you write to your full pool should be at least kept for 1 year, and here you just define this file size if you store this to file. Similar on the incremental, you just say incrementals, I only want to keep for at least 30 days, and and so on. This has been now about Barreiros configuration, but only if you, but this currently only do this for the server itself. If you want to add a client, you have to install the Barreiros file daemon on the client, then you have configure it. On the client and on the server, and then we started on the client. So go through this, add the Barreiros repository on the client, install the package Barreiros file daemon. Then, since the current version, you can on the server side issue a command configure adds a client with this name, with this address, with this password. If you missed some settings here, then it will complain. Or if it's you did something wrong, it will complain. This will create the configuration for the directory itself, for the server. It will also create a snippet of the configuration for the client, so that later on you can just use SCP the configuration for the client to the client and then restart the client. Yeah. Okay. If you have done so, you can verify that the client is working with status client. This will initiate a TCP connection to the client. You can check what files would get backupped if I would run a job. You do this with estimate listing. Yeah, and so on. After this, you can add a job. You can take a look with status schedule when the job for this will be triggered, and then run the job. But these things you can also do with the web UI. Run scripts, as we have been asked before. So you have your normal job, and you can add one or more run scripts to it. And you are quite flexible, so you define this run script should run before your backup starts, it should be executed on the client, it should execute this command, in this case dump your Postgres database to a file, and if this fails, the job should fail. Yes?
Can you do the setting as well on the web UI, or is that...?
No, the setting you can't be done, no. But it's only done on the server and not on the client. This has a disadvantage that you dump your database and have an extra file, which consumes also some disk space. But there are ways around it. The most basic plugin for Boreas is a bpipe plugin. So instead of creating a file, you make your dump your database, so for the reader, and then say, use the standard outputs and create a virtual file, not on the file system, but in the backup, with this name, Postgres SQL, dump SQL, or whatever you want to name it. When doing so, run the compression around it, so this shrinks the data, and it has also the settings for restore, so hopefully you can restore your database with this command. You have more sophisticated plugins, for example, for MySQL or MariaDB, which integrates Percona extra backup. With this, you are able to make incremental backups of your MySQL database, hot backups, and point-in-time recovery. It's a so-called Python plugin, so it's some lines written in Python. So you specify, use the Python plugin, look at this path, various plugins, the plugin name is Boreas FD Percona and has this configuration. You have this also for VMware. As we have this question before, in this case you are able to do incremental backups of your virtual machines in VMware. It connects to your vSphere server, and enables the feature of change block tracking, so on incrementals it only changes the blocks that have been changed since the last backup. Also a Python plugin.
Is this block-based exclusively, this part, or is this also file-based?
This is block-based.
This one, okay, so you just pretend like the block device is a big file.
Sure, but we use the VMware API for this, and therefore we can do this incremental stuff on this. Point is agentless. Yes?
What access rights do you need on the VMware environment to run this test?
I'm not sure. Maybe you ask Stefan, because he has written the plugin, but...
VMware, you can set up in vSphere. I have only used the administrator rights.
Okay, next thing is NDMP. NDMP is a backup interface provided by the large storage systems like NetApp, Isilon, and so on. And in this way, the storage system itself creates the backup jobs, and Boreas is able to handle them. It can also do this with full and incremental backups, and also a single file with store. Yeah, this we will skip. This we will skip. ACL, as mentioned before, it's also used with the web UI. And as an example for the web UI, you can create a new user, say use the profile web UI admin, and in this case you have access to all resources in the default installation, but and to all commands except of the list of commands written in there. Or some other case, you can define a console for another user, which only get access to client 1 and client 2 and also a set of the file sets and so on. So, roadmap. What we plan to do for the next major release is PAM authentication, because now currently we handle these things by ourselves. But PAM authentication, in principle, it's working since a longer time, but we have to change the handshaking network initiation between the daemons, so it's a bit more effort, but we have an external contribution with claims that he has fulfilled this, and yeah, we're looking forward to get this integrated. I've been asked how large Barrios environments could be. So if you have several thousand clients and a large number of files especially, yeah, we discovered some bottlenecks in the database, but we have been able to fix major ones, and this is already done for a specific customer right now, and we're on the way to integrate it to Barrios Master. The Python interface will get to core. NDMP, I'm not sure if you use this, but we are quite busy to extend this, because currently backup data is sent from your storage to the Barrios storage daemon, and he will care about the data. But NDMP also offers a mode where it can write data directly to a directly attached tape library. And yeah, we are quite confident and have also done a prototype how to solve this, because this is then much faster, because you don't need to transfer the data through the network and direct access restore. Just fastens single file restore. So have you time for questions? Yes. So question.
The replication for the storage daemons, is the client sending to multiple daemons?
No. Of course, you can do it in a way that the client does the backup twice and send it to different storage daemons. But the normal case is you have a set of rules about what jobs already exist and what jobs should be copied or migrated to another storage daemon. So job twice, and you have a rule set for doing so.
For scripting, how's the compatibility with Bacula?
The basic script should work, and of course if you extended commands then it will not work in Bacula, but the other way around, I don't see an issue.
From a couple of years ago from Bacula.
Yeah, sure. So we forked from Bacula 5.2, and everything which worked there should still work here.
Okay. Can you please repeat the question? Are
Bacula scripts compatible with Barrios?
Okay.
Yes?
Do you always need the port open?
Sorry, can you repeat this a bit louder?
Do you always need the port open on the VM that you need to back up?
No. You connect to the vSphere server and he will send the data that you need to know.
In general, not specifically for VMware.
So, otherwise you have not a port open. If you use client initiated connection, then it's the other way around, so the client connects to the director. Yeah. Okay. Time's up, but I'm still here, so maybe you can get there.